morning. You're a little bit fuzzy. I've got a cheap pair of $15 reading glasses on here. My glasses broke a while back, and I haven't forked over for some new ones. My wife told me she likes these better. My other ones are kind of minimal, so it doesn't look like I'm wearing anything, so I'm not sure what that says about the way she likes the way I look, but I'm getting a complex these days because now this is the first service we actually live stream. So what they're looking at right now is what went on today, not pre-recorded, not edited, nothing. So what they saw is what everybody's getting now. I've had some people tell me through this time that they prefer me on video or TV more than in person. Now, John is one of the, actually he used the words from behind a pulpit, so I'm not using a pulpit today, John, so hopefully that's good. I don't quite know how to take that. I'm going to take that as a compliment. I think maybe people like, you know, the on-location thing, some of the illustrative stuff, or maybe just the fact that maybe I seem too inhibited behind a pulpit, or maybe I'm not inhibited enough. I had to, you know, keep those little things concise. You know, I think I've done a lot of 4 or 5 minute things. The longest I've preached, some of the things we recorded is 23 or 4 minutes. So I'm ready to cut loose this morning, all right? So you got to sit down and get ready for it. But anyway, I'm the one you got, and it's on me this morning to bring closure to our Red Letter series that we started at the beginning of the year, dealing with the words of Jesus throughout Scripture. And I'm not quite sure why I'm the one to close it out. And Pastor Jeff said a few weeks ago that there are over 65,000 words of Jesus in the Gospels. And I figure we've covered about a few thousand of those. So I don't know, maybe they think that if I talk as fast as I've been known to do when I'm live and in person, I can cover the other 60,000 here in about the next 35 minutes or so. So I'm not actually going to try to do that, but we are going to cover some ground. And we're going to do it from a place where we might not typically expect to find the red letters, because up till now we've taken all of our messages from the Gospels, which makes sense because that's the record of Jesus' life here on earth. But I want to go past the Gospels, past the book of Acts and the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, the instigation of the church, through the letters in the New Testament that dealt with issues in those churches, all the way to the other end, to the point where Jesus gives an assessment of his churches about 60 to 65 years after his resurrection and ascension. And he does so in a vision to the Apostle John while he was on the island of Patmos. He was confined there for preaching the gospel. And that vision is recorded in the book of Revelation. So take your Bibles, turn to the book of Revelation. We're going to go through 2 chapters very quickly. It's not all going to be up there. I'm going to depend on, get it on your device, open up the word, we're going to get to it. But he gives that vision in Revelation. Right from verse 1 of chapter 1, he says this is a revelation of Jesus Christ. Now the word there, revelation, talks about, implies an uncovering or revealing. So it's Jesus' revelation about himself. But the picture we get in the book of Revelation is quite a bit different than what we saw in the Gospels, because in Revelation 1 verse 12, it says that John turned around to see the voice that was speaking to him. And when he turned, he saw 7 golden lampstands, and among the lampstands, and he describes that he's wearing a robe down to his feet, a golden sash, his hair was white like wool, his eyes were like blazing fire, his feet were like bronze, and his voice was like the sound of rushing water. He had stars held in his hands, and out of his mouth came a sharp double-edged sword. That's a very imposing image, and John says in verse 17 that when I saw him, I fell at his feet as though dead. And then he placed his right hand on me and said, "Do not be afraid. I am the first and the last. I am the living one. I was dead, and behold, I am alive forever and ever, and hold the keys of death and Hades." Now, I don't have time to unpack all the symbolism there and even the places that we go, some of the prophetic elements, because I'm going to stay very practical to what Jesus is saying to some of the churches there. But just suffice it to say, this is a lot different image than we see of the dusty-footed carpenter turned itinerant evangelist and suffering servant that is evident throughout the Gospels. Because when Jesus returns and parts the clouds and every eye beholds him, he's going to return as a victorious Savior and a conquering King to rid the world of sin once and for all and to reign with his people forever and ever. And that's the images we get toward the end of the book of Revelation. But at the beginning, he takes time to address, as it says in chapter 1, verse 4, to the seven churches. And these churches were in the Roman province of Asia Minor, which is modern-day Turkey. And it goes on in verse 19. He says, write what you have seen, what now will take place. And he's writing, and he says, the seven stars are the angels of the seven churches, and the seven lampstands are the seven churches. So Christ has got the churches in his hand. He's walking among them. He knows what's going on. And that's who he addresses at the beginning of the book of Revelation. And that's where the letter was originally sent. Now, these congregations, probably were several congregations comprised in these cities, more than just one local gathering in each one. And the number seven, it obviously went to seven places, but when Scripture uses the word seven, usually a little more going on. And I think here it's speaking to a completeness, a wholeness, that this message going out to the seven churches is something that's not only relevant to them at that time, but it's relevant to us as all of God's word is to this very day. And what he's saying to those churches, he's wanting to say to us. So my outline today is simply looking, we're going to look at the seven churches, what's going on, good and bad, and see what Jesus says to them, because the principles that we find there are things that we need to take heed of in our lives today, because God is wanting to say something to us. Now, we're seeing these. We're going to see some encouragement, but we're also going to see some challenges, because Jesus is noting some things that have taken place and crept into the church and have caused them to drift in their relationship with God. And he's saying to many of them, repent. You need to turn around and get back to it if I'm going to use you in the way they want. And so that's what we're going to see in the seven churches. And I'm going to take a little bit of what I'm going to call a prophetic approach to this. Not that I'm a prophet, but this is a prophetic book. And I'm not going to pull any punches. I'm going to speak very directly. I'm going to say some things that may be a little bit uncomfortable to hear, because I believe that God is wanting to get us ready for some powerful things in the days ahead. So turn over to Revelation chapter 2. And we're going to take a look at the first of these messages to the seven churches, and that's to the church in Ephesus. You might recognize that there was a book in the New Testament to the Ephesians, so some of these had probably gotten that letter as well. But it says in chapter 2, verse 1, to the angel in the church of Ephesus write, these are the words of him who holds the seven stars in his right hand and walks among the seven golden lampstands. I know your deeds, your hard work, your perseverance. I know that you cannot tolerate wicked people, that you have tested those who claim to be apostles but are not, and have found them false. You have persevered and have endured hardship for my name and have not grown weary. Now, if we stop there, we're looking at a church that looks to be in pretty good shape. I mean, you see hard work and perseverance, devotion to the truth, they're rejecting evil, they've got enough depth in the word of discernment that they can tell those things from one another. It even says that they endured hardship and didn't give in. They checked all the boxes. This is a church that really appears that they had it together. But apparently over time, they had come to the place where the ministry of the God had become bigger than the God of the ministry. They had religion without relationship. They were trying to serve a God that they really weren't taking time to get to know. And apparently they had started out better with that passionate relationship for Christ. But he says in verse number 4, this is what I hold against you. You have forsaken the love you had at first. Your translation might say you've lost your first love. So Jesus' challenge to this first church is that we can have all the right beliefs, we can do a lot of the right things, and still not be in right relationship with God. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians 1:9, tells us that our primary calling is into fellowship and relationship with Jesus. Not just to believe in him, not just to know some things about him or do things for him, but to have that personal, passionate relationship with him that should be evident in everything we do. Are we taking that consistent personal time with God? Are we going throughout our day with an intense awareness of his presence? Are we always thinking about Jesus? Are we looking for ways to pursue his purposes and to avoid anything that could compromise our devotion to Christ? In 1 Corinthians chapter 13, that's the love chapter. It starts out by saying that we can do all kinds of service and even sacrifice our very lives, and yet all of that means nothing if we don't have love. And that love needs to come from a passionate pursuit of Jesus himself. And neglecting that is so serious that Jesus describes it here, that condition, as fallen. That's the same way he describes a world that's lost in sin. In verse number 5, he says, consider how far you have fallen. Repent and do the things you did at first. For if you do not repent, I will come to you and remove your lampstand from its place. The only remedy for that lost love was that they had to repent and get back to the things they were doing before, because all the things that they thought they were accomplishing were nothing, because they were just doing it their way rather than doing it God's way. And you may recall in the Gospels when people come before him at the judgment and they say, Lord, all the great things we've done miracles in your name, cast out demons, healings, all this type of stuff. And he's going to turn to them and say, depart from me, I never knew you. That relationship wasn't there. And there were probably other things going on with that crowd, but I cannot overemphasize the seriousness of neglecting the one who we claim to love and follow and to serve. So we need to ask ourselves this: are we staying both doctrinally pure and spiritually passionate? Are we simply trying to do things for Jesus, but not take time to actually be with him? That's the lesson we need to take from the Ephesian church. The second church is the church in Smyrna. That takes place in 2:8. We see the message there. A little different things going on here. It says, to the angel of the church of Smyrna write, these are the words of him who is the first and the last, who died and came to life again. Now he's reminding them of something that they're going to need to hang on to because of what they're going through and what he addresses. He says in verse 9, I know your afflictions, your poverty, yet you are rich. I know I know about the slander of those who say they are Jews but are not, but are of the synagogue of Satan. Do not be afraid of what you are about to suffer. I tell you, the devil will put some of you in prison and test you, and you'll suffer persecution for 10 days. But be faithful even unto the point of death, and I will give you a victor's crown, or a crown of life. Now, a lot of different stuff going on here than with Ephesus, because the Ephesian church looked like everything was thriving and going well on the outside, but there were a lot of problems internally. But he addresses this church in 2:9 and says that they're in poverty. And the word used for poverty there literally means that they had nothing at all. Now, Smyrna was a proud city of the Roman Empire, and they were very eager to do the bidding of the empire, but there was also a large contingent of Jews that claimed to believe in God, but they rejected Christ. So it was an extremely hostile situation for Christians, because even the people who should have been sympathetic to their cause were against them. You may have heard the name Polycarp in church history. He was the bishop of this place in Smyrna. But even though this church was socially and economically destitute, Jesus says that you are spiritually rich. And that's a huge contrast to one of the churches we're going to see in just a bit that had a lot of wealth, but God described them as pitiful and poor. Now, when you're going through a tough time and you don't seem to have anything, or maybe a church is experiencing a lot of opposition, or they don't seem to have the resource or the opportunity that other places have, it's easy to question whether we're really on the right track. And when things go from bad to worse, it's really easy to just feel like giving up. And that's what was going on in this passage here, because he told them it was going to get worse. They were going to suffer persecution, where some of them were even going to be at the point of giving their life for him. But he encouraged them and said, you're on the right track. And if you remain faithful to me, even when facing death, you have in store for you a crown of life. And it wasn't about their ability to overcome. It was by complete dependence on Jesus. Because for persecuted Christ followers, temporary suffering always gives way to eternal glory. So we need to ask ourselves this question: are we willing, are we allowing tough times to steal our faith rather than to strengthen it? Because that's what it'll do if we allow God to make the most of that time. Is serving Jesus just a matter of convenience, or is it costing me something? It was costing the believers in Smyrna. The third church is a church in Pergamum. That looks there in verse number 12 of chapter 3. Had a little bit of a similar situation, but they were handling it quite different. It says to the angel in the church of Pergamum, write, these are the words of him who has the sharp double-edged sword. And that represents God's word, because as we're going to see, that's what they were compromising. And it goes on to say, I know where you live, where Satan has his throne, yet you remain true to my name. You did not renounce your faith in me, not even in the days of Antipas, my faithful witness, who was put to death in your city, where Satan lives. He emphasized that a couple of times because, again, we're dealing with a place where the influence of evil was extremely prominent. And when it mentions that person, Antipas, he's thought to be the first Christian to lose his life for his faith in Christ in Asia. According to tradition, he was roasted to death in a bronze kettle. So the threat was very real. It had presented, and they knew what was going on. And yet it says that they had still hung on to their faith. This was a solid-looking, determined church. And yet in verse 14, it says, "Nevertheless, I have a few things against you. There are some of you who hold to the teaching of Balaam, who taught Balak to entice the Israelites to sin. So they ate food, sacrificed to idols, and committed sexual immorality. Likewise, you also hold to the teaching of the Nicolaitans." Now, I mentioned that with the Ephesian church well, but I didn't get into it, and I will in just a second. "Repent, therefore, otherwise I will soon come to you, and I," Jesus himself says, he'll fight against those who are putting forth some of these false doctrines. Now, a couple serious issues going on with this church, and they had to do with what they were tolerating. They were tolerating false teaching, and they were tolerating immoral behavior among the church members. When it talks about the teaching of Balaam, Balaam was a false prophet in the Old Testament who sold his services to an ungodly king, and he advised the Midianite women how to tempt the Israelite men to compromise their devotion to God through idol worship and other immoral behavior. So Balaam represents anyone in the church, leaders or lay people, who influences others to compromise with worldly beliefs and behaviors. And some in Pergamum were doing that because they felt that as long as you believe the right things, it didn't really matter what your lifestyle was. And that sounds very familiar to what goes on and what goes out in a lot of churches today. That's what the Nicolaitans that it mentioned there, that's what they believe. They thought that because of God's grace, they were free to engage in immoral behaviors without any consequence because grace covered all that. But grace is not a license to sin. Grace is empowerment to overcome sin. And that's why Jesus concludes each one of these passages by talking about the one who overcomes or is victorious is the one who's going to taste of the fruits of heaven. But those described here had begun to compartmentalize their faith to where Christ was just an experience rather than something that saturated their entire being. And the problem wasn't worldliness pushing its way into the church. It was people in the church pulling worldly philosophies and practices into the church and influencing others to do the same. And it starts out very subtly. We just begin to justify behaviors that are very common and accepted in the culture, but really aren't beneficial to us as believers. And the specific things it mentions here, we're going to see in the next church as well. Sexual immorality and food offered to idols. You might recognize that food and idol issue from Paul addressing legalism a lot throughout the New Testament when he was talking about what churches should and shouldn't make acceptable. And I hear Christians talk a lot about legalism. And Paul does throughout the New Testament because turning faith into a list of do's and don'ts always keeps people out of God's kingdom. And that's what was going on early on with many of the churches in the New Testament. But as time goes on and people progress in that relationship, another problem creeps into the church that is equally as destructive, but we don't deal with that often because it offends people. Because the issue of legalism was big at the start of the church because, especially with the Jews who are trying to transition in their thought process from a law-based mentality to understanding that salvation was a matter of faith and grace. And legalism was the main problem at that time of keeping people from coming in to the new church. But as churches and individual Christians move on, they drift toward that other end of the spectrum where legalism is not as much as a problem as it is taking license and liberty to do things that really are more of imitating the culture than they are of being godly. And that's why Jesus' message to these established churches deals more with that issue. And it's the same thing that many of the Old Testament prophets dealt with when they had to continually come to the people and say, "You're following the people around you, you're not following God." And that's what was going on here. But we need to understand that conforming to our culture will keep us from transforming the culture. God calls us for to be the agents of change, not to conform to the things around us. So we need to ask ourselves this: are the ungodly influences around us diluting our faith and diminishing our effectiveness for Christ? Because that's what we'll do if you let that creep into the church. Am I listening more to what I want to hear than what I need to hear. Because that's what allowed them to get off into some of these false teachings. They were doing what was a lot easier to hear rather than some of the tough challenges that they needed to take to heart. The fourth church, there's some similarity going. I'm dealing with these two a little more at length, and then the last three will go pretty quickly. But the church in Thyatira, I've labeled that the misguided church. Now, that's maybe kind because some people will label this as the adulterous church. And it picks up in chapter 2, verse 18. To the angel of the church at Thyatira write, "These are the words of the Son of God, whose eyes are like blazing fire and feet like burnished bronze. I know your deeds, your love, your faith, your service and perseverance, and that you are now doing more than you did at first." And again, we see what looks like a very solid church. I mean, they were full of faith, good works, and even unlike the church in Ephesus, they were actually growing in their faith. It says, you're doing more than you did at first. And even commends them for their love. So this was a church that had a lot of sincerity to what they believed and what they were doing. But sincerity is not the measure of what's right. There are a lot of people who are sincerely misguided, who are sincerely wrong. And that's what we see going on in this church. And in verse number 20, he says, "This is what I have against you. You tolerate that woman Jezebel, who calls herself a prophet. By her teaching, she misleads my servants into sexual immorality, eating food sacrificed to idols." There it is again. "I have given her time to repent, but she is unwilling." I look at this church, and like so many churches today, here are people who had been seduced by all kinds of worldly philosophies and sensuality and everything that tickled their ears. And when it comes to tolerating that woman Jezebel, some of you may recall that was a queen in the Old Testament whose name has now become kind of synonymous with sensuality and idol worship and manipulation. And she represents anyone in the church who promotes what in theological terms we would call a libertine lifestyle. And that's a lifestyle that encourages a pursuit of pleasure. And again, just like in the other church, they claim that grace frees them from all these things that they just see as religious rules and regulations. But while they resisted legalism, they were erring on the opposite extreme. And it's interesting in the New Testament, when Paul deals a lot with legalism in the New Testament, he cites these same two issues that Jesus says here, sexual immorality and food offered to idols. Now, with that food issue, you might remember that what was going on is people would go to the local market and they would get meat. And in a lot of cases, it was meat that people had presented as an offering to a false god. And so some Christians could eat that in good conscience and others couldn't. And so arguing against legalism, Paul points out that idols are nothing and food is nothing. It goes in one side and goes out the other. It wasn't a matter of touching their spirit. So people were free to live according to their conscience. But then he also goes on to say that our consciences are not the final authority. And there is a clear scriptural mandate when it comes to dealing with matters of conscience. And I'm going to be honest with what some of those things are. We know what those things are in the culture today, what we've made matters of conscience. Things like entertainment choices, things like fashion trends, alcohol. There are a lot of others, but those are some of the big ones that we think of when maybe we talk about matters of conscience. And the Bible has a clear rule when it comes to those things that I don't hear an awful lot about. I mean, I hear a lot of people talk about, when they talk about legalism, you know, they get on things that they think that they should be able to do or not be able to do, and they may try to encourage others or what they should be free or not to do. And I hear a lot of those things, but I don't hear a lot of the clear scriptural principle that should govern all this in Romans chapter 14, 22, when it says, "Whatever you believe about these things, keep between yourself and God. Blessed is the one who does not condemn himself by what he approves." And the way we condemn ourselves is when we influence others to do things that may defy their conscience or just simply not be in their best interest. Because there's no denying that some of those issues that we've made matters of conscience do mess some people up. Some people, it takes them down a path of temptation and lust and overindulgence and addiction and all kinds of lifestyles that will pull them away from God. And we aren't considering the good of others when we put our freedom ahead of that. And God takes that very seriously. And one more thing about that issue of legalism. When the New Testament cites things like circumcision or food and all that, that's outward stuff. It doesn't touch the spirit. But a lot of the things that we try to make as big issues of legalism are issues that the New Testament deals with quite differently, because the New Testament handles very differently issues that come into the mind and get into the spirit. And that's why it's very important for us to be careful about what we watch or how we're presenting ourselves or that we're doing anything. And maybe, as the Bible says, even have that scent of hint of sexual immorality, because those things are going to influence people in many of the wrong ways. No one rails harder against legalism than the Apostle Paul. But when he talks about issues like this and says that food is nothing and idols are nothing, he still concludes in almost every one of those situations, you know what? It's just best to refrain. It's just not best to go there. In fact, in Acts chapter 15, when he's addressing Gentile believers and he's trying to make sure he doesn't put on them any more of a burden of those legalistic things, he mentions these same two issues. He said, avoid sexual immorality and avoid food offered to idols. Even though he had just said all that shouldn't be a big deal, don't do it. And I see a lot of people get very defensive about certain behaviors, and I think, well, if it's really no big deal, then it shouldn't be a big deal to do or not do those things if it's a matter that may taking people down the wrong path, because this church was not concerning themselves with those things, and Jesus challenged them very strongly about that. So when things are, if you can do something, don't flaunt that freedom. It's not your job to try to convince anybody how free they should be if they just had a deep spiritual understanding, because the Bible says that's when our knowledge and our freedom actually can cross a line into sin. Don't flaunt it out there on social media to show everything you can do. Keep it between you and God, and let others live as God is calling them to in their conscience as well. In practical terms, all that means we need to be careful about the influence we have with our behaviors on others, because that will affect their spiritual lives. The question we need to ask ourselves is this: has ministry fruitfulness and success caused us to rationalize immoral behavior or to overlook sin? Or am I using my spiritual freedom as a license to indulge in questionable behavior? Because that's what was going on in these churches, and Jesus offers a strong rebuke to that. The next church is a church in Sardis, and that starts in chapter 3. So look in chapter 3, verse 1. It says, to the angel of the church of Sardis write, these are the words of him who upholds the seven spirits of God and the seven stars. I know your deeds. Every time he says, I know your deeds, I know what you're up to. We can fool people, we can't fool God. He says, you have a reputation of being alive, but you are dead. Wake up! Exclamation point. Strengthen what remains as it about to die, for I have found your deeds unfinished in the sight of my God. Remember, therefore, what you have received and heard. Hold to it fast and repent, because if you don't wake up, I will come like a thief, and you will not know at what time I come to you. You know, I can't help but wonder, looking at this church, how many churches did it today, including some of those that are held up in Christian circles as high examples, how many of them might fit the description here of the church of Sardis? Because they might appear to have it all together. They might appear that things are great on the outside, but on the inside, people don't even know that there's death. There's nothing going on. So whether it's our own self-evaluation, whether it's the way we look at other churches, we need to be careful about judging by appearances, because things are not always what they seem. And successful ministries or dynamic worship and all those things are never a substitute for the true purity and power of the Holy Spirit. Reputations are going to fool a lot of people, but Jesus sees through it all. He knows when a church has what the Bible calls a form of godliness, but it lacks the power. And if things didn't change with this church or any church like that, he says they're not going to make it in the end. Because in verse number 5, when he talks about not having your name blotted out of the book of life, that's basically telling us that we can lose our place in God's purpose if we let those things creep in. Because a strong reputation is never a substitute for weak faith. So ask yourself this question: are we relying on image, traditions, or past experiences? Are we authentically alive and growing in our relationship with Jesus? The sixth church was a church in Philadelphia. It says, write to the angel of the church in Philadelphia. These are the words of him who is holy and true, who holds the keys of David. What he opens, no one can shut. What he shuts, no one can open. I know your deeds. See, I have placed before you an open door that no one can shut. I know that you have little strength, yet you have kept my word and have not denied my name. So I will make those who are of the synagogue of Satan, who claim to be Jews, though they are not, but are liars, I'll make them come and fall down at your feet and acknowledge that I have loved you. Since you have kept my word and endured patiently, I will also keep you in the hour of trial. And just like the church in Smyrna, there was not any rebuke for this church. They had lived by the word. They had endured opposition. They had resisted conforming to the culture. And through it all, they had remained true to Christ. And because of that, because of their faithfulness, God said that he would open doors of ministry for them and that he would rescue them or keep them from the hour of trial. That phrase, keep from, can either mean keep you from experiencing or keep you through. And we need to remember both things, because there are times that God is going to take us through some things. And we just need to take comfort in the fact that he's with us and doesn't leave us. But he also promises in the end of it all, he's going to rescue us from the judgment that's ultimately coming on this world. But no matter what you're going through, including all the stuff that our culture is going through now, God has a way of turning opposition into open doors. He did it for them. He's going to do it for us. If you didn't look at my devotion for a little while back about God will do it again, go back and look. We look at what's going on in the culture today and think these are unprecedented times. We've never seen the like of it. We've been here before. We've seen even worse. And out of that, God has done some very powerful things. But we need to get ourselves ready if God is going to use us in the way that he wants to. And relying on God's strength in tough times is going to bring opportunities for godly influence. So ask yourself this. Am I persistently trusting God for strength despite my troubles and weaknesses? And am I following Christ through the open doors of ministry in my city and the world? Now, before I look at the last church, I want to point out something that you may have noticed already. It's very interesting. Have you noticed that the strongest rebukes and calls for repentance went out to the churches that on the surface seem to be the most effective and successful? And the only two churches that didn't receive any rebuke but only praise were the two that on the outside looked like they were struggling, that looked like they didn't have anything, that they were suffering. Those are the ones that God commends. And all that to say that no matter how effective or relevant that things may seem in a church, don't assume that there's not need for a wake-up call. And I'm not pointing the finger at anyone here. I believe that we're doing what God wants us to. But if we opened our lives and kept them open to the scrutiny of the Holy Spirit so he can make sure that we are who he's calling us to be. And by the same token, if you're struggling and feeling weak and inadequate, but you know that you're trusting God and you're pursuing his purposes, you can take heart that God is with you, he'll take care of you, and he's got a crown of life for you at the end of the road. But whatever's going on in your life, be assured that God knows it and he understands it. And he certainly did in this last church in Laodicea. This church is probably the most familiar and recognizable of all the churches you'll see in just a second. He says in verse 14, to the angel of church in Laodicea, write this. These are the words of the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the ruler of God's creation. I know your deeds, that you are neither hot or cold. I wish you were one or the other, but because you are lukewarm, neither hot or cold, I am about to spit you out of my mouth. You say, I am rich, I have acquired wealth, and do not need a thing, but you do not realize that you are wretched, pitiful, poor, blind, and naked. If we were to finish that passage, we'd see that in that church, unlike Philadelphia, this church only received rebuke. Every other church that we looked at, there was at least some point of encouragement or praise. But what was going on here was so serious that all Christ could say is you need to repent. You need to change and turn back. And the problem Jesus had with this church is they were riding the fence. And the only thing that happens when you ride the fence is you get splinters in places it's hard to pull them out. And I'm telling you, they weren't hot enough to recognize or respond to the guidance of the Holy Spirit, and they weren't cold enough to realize that they needed to repent. All that was happening is their success and all the outward trappings were masking the fact that they were in a very pitiful state. And that state of trying to be of worldly, trying to be kind of like the world, but trying to like God, you always end up looking a lot more like worldly culture than you do a God's kingdom. And that type of condition is very putrid to God. Now, I don't mean to get crude here, but when I was young and I felt sick, you know, and if you ever felt sick and you know if you could just upchuck and get it out, you'd feel a lot better. And so my mom would give me a glass of warm water. And all I needed to do is bring that to my lip, kind of get it partway down, and it just made me. And that's the way God feels about a church that's lukewarm, because the tragedy of lukewarmness is it not only impedes Christ's work in our lives and in the church, but it gives others on the outside an entirely skewed image of what it means to follow Jesus and even who Jesus is. And the result here was a church that had a lot of outward prosperity, but they were oblivious to their inward poverty, because Jesus' own words, they were wretched, pitiful, and blind. And in verse 18, he speaks directly to their sources of pride and self-dependence, because that city was known for its wealth, but God told them they needed an uncompromised wealth of faith that was worth far more than worldly riches. They had an extensive textile and clothing industry, but he said, you need to be clothed with purity and righteousness. They produced a powder that made an eye salve that was exported all over, but he said, only God could help you recognize your true condition and change in the power of the Holy Spirit. But God says in verse 19, those that I love, I rebuke and discipline. He was doing this because these were his children. And the bottom line of all of it is spiritual complacency is repulsive to God, misleading to others, and detrimental to our faith. And the only solution in this case, and in our case today, as we find ourselves here, is we need to repent and get right with God. And in verse number 20, you recognize this. It says, here I am, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come into him and eat with that person, and they with me. Usually we cite that verse with people who haven't received a relationship with Christ, but he wrote that to a church that had neglected their relationship with him and left him standing on the outside of their lukewarm life. And so this is an invitation that Christ wants to come in and sit around the table and feast with you on his word. And later on in chapter 19 of Revelation, it speaks of a great wedding banquet where Christ will sit down with his bride, which is the church. But realize that only people who sit down with him now are going to sit down with him at that time. He says in verse 21, to the one who is victorious, I will give them the right to sit with him on my throne, just as I was victorious and sat down with my Father on his throne. So ask yourself this, have we taken God's blessing for granted and allowed apathy to erode our passion for Christ? And is the door of my heart open to the constant presence of Jesus? Pastor Brad, if you'd come and just begin to play something softly. If I could sum up the problems in all these churches, it'd be two main things. The first one is simply the loss of love and passion for Jesus himself. They fall out of touch with that personal relationship. And the second thing is a willingness to compromise with worldly beliefs and behavior. So if we find ourselves in that condition, any sort, anything going on in these churches, the remedy, Jesus says, is to repent. In verse 22, it says, whoever has ears to hear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the church. He says that after every one. If you got ears to hear. Now, when it talks about hearing in the scriptural sense, that isn't just sound coming to your ears. Hearing means that you listen and you respond in obedience to God's word. Because that's the only standard worth measuring our life. That's the only standard any of these churches could look to and begin to pattern their lives around. And if that's not happening, that can be halted, that can be turned around if we're willing to repent, change our ways to align with God's ways. In every one of the previous challenges to these churches, Jesus concludes by promising a reward to those who overcome. But an overcomer means one that's turning and getting in the right direction and going with God. The bottom line is this. We either overcome sin and Satan in the world, or we're overcome by those things. There's no middle ground. And that's the call that Jesus gives to us today. I want you to bow your heads for just a minute. I'm gonna give a tough challenge here, and I'm gonna ask you to respond in a way that may not be easy. But we're living in some times where it's becoming very apparent how quickly things can change. And I don't say that to discourage anybody, because I believe out of these times, God is getting ready to do something very powerful. But we need to be ready to walk through that door with him. And we need to be in a state where we are vessels that he can use in any way he chooses, not clouded with any of these things that we saw in the churches of Revelation, in our church or in our individual lives. So I'm going to ask you to take a stand this morning for some things. And if you've heard some of these things and you know in your heart that you can relate, maybe you relate to the church in Ephesus, and you're working for God, you're serving, you're not going off in the wrong direction, but you just say, you know what, I've lost a bit of that first love. I've lost that passion. I'm serving, but I feel dry, and I need to get that back. I haven't strayed from God. I haven't turned from him, but I need that passion back. I need to renew that first love. If that's you this morning, I'm going to ask you right where you're at without any hesitation to stand. I'm going to pray for you. You're not going to be alone, I guarantee it. The next one, if you find yourself like that church in Smyrna and you find yourself going through a tough time and you're suffering and you don't see the way out and it just seems to be getting from bad to worse, you say, God, I need to understand. I need to let you strengthen me through this because I know you're going to take me through whatever I face, and you just need God's strength to go through that today. Would you stand and join these saying, I need God's strength today? The next two I'm going to kind of deal with together, that Pergamum and the Thyatira. These are churches that began to little bit of compromise to come in. And they were strong churches. Man, they were enduring. They were doing some great things. So I'm not saying you backslid. But there are some things in these confusing times that maybe just starting to pull you one way or the other. You aren't quite sure how to handle them or what to do about them. And maybe there's ways you look and say, I haven't been the influence that I should. Maybe even some ways that I haven't been. You say, I need to get with that. I need to pull back in that right direction and turn. And any hint of compromise in my life, I don't want that anymore. And you'll stand with these. I want to pray for you as well. Be bold. And if you're here this morning, you say, you know what? People might look at me and think I got it together. And maybe you're not even trying to fool anybody with a reputation, but you're just not where you've been in the past. You're not as far as you've been at one point there. And people looking at you maybe think you got it more together than you do. I can tell. I can be like that. A lot of people give me credit for stuff over time, and I know I haven't been there. I'm standing with you there. And you say, I have a reputation that maybe exceeds where I'm really at, and I need to stand. I need to get back that fire. I need to get back that passion. I don't want to be spiritually dead and dry. I want to be alive, and that's you. Would you stand and join these as well? And if you're like the believers in Philadelphia and you're going through something and you say, I know God's got an open door for this in somewhere. I know he wants to bring something. I don't know what, but I don't want to miss it. I want to recognize it when it comes, and I want to walk through him with that, even though right now I'm in a tough time. Would you stand? I'm going to pray for you with these as well. And the last thing we just talked about, so I won't go elaborate on it, but you just say, I'm just in that lukewarm state. I'm not cold, but I'm not hot. I'm spiritually dry, and it's just not there right now. And I need to get back to it, and you know some of the things that may take, but you say, I just need to get passionate for God again because I'm in that lukewarm state, and I don't want to be there anymore. And that's you. Would you stand and join these? And I'm going to pray for you in just a second. Before I do, I want to ask one last thing. I wanted to do it while others were standing to let them know they're not alone. But if you're here today and you don't have a personal relationship with God, you know that you're not going to sit down at that great wedding supper at the end of time with him and be in eternity with him. The Bible says we've all gone our own way, and that's what sin is, and that prevents us from having a relationship with God. It's as simple as that. And the penalty for sin is death, eternal separation from him. But if you're willing to acknowledge today, acknowledge that sin, say, God, I've gone my own. Will you forgive me? I want to become your child. I'm going to pray for you today. And if that's you and you want to enter that relationship with God, or maybe you've walked away and you're wanting to renew that, would you stand with these? Because I want to pray for you first of all this morning that God would come in and take your life and make you his child. I'm going to pray first for anybody who may be doing that. Lord, this morning, not asking them to repeat after me anything, but in their heart, Lord, those who are standing for that last thing, just in their own heart are right now acknowledging their sin before you. They've gone their own way, but they're saying, God, forgive me. I believe you're the Son of God who died in my place and rose again with the power and authority to give me a new life. Forgive me that sin. Make me your child. I want to spend eternity with you. I want to live a life that serves the purpose that the one who made it knows. And I want to live for you. Lord, I thank you for anybody who prayed that in their heart today. If you did that, I want you to catch me or one of the pastors afterwards and say, hey, I prayed that prayer. We've got some stuff we'd like to give you. Get tied into a church. This is a great one where you begin to grow in your relationship with God. But let me pray for the rest of you. And as I do, I just want everybody to stand, all right? Join these. I'm not singling out those who stand. You took a bold stand, and God's going to honor that this morning as we pray. And only you know what it is that you might need to change. That's where repentance is. You make the changes you need. That's where it gets really practical. And I'm going to pray that God will give you the strength to do that. Lord, I pray right now in Jesus' name, whatever it was that they're dealing with in this place today, for those who maybe lost a bit of that first love and passion for God, they're immersed in ministry, they're doing things, they love you, but Lord, they're really not taking that time like they should to continue. I pray, bring them back to that place. Bring them back to those practical disciplines of prayer and word, and Lord, light that fire in their life. Lord, for those who are struggling, as a couple of these churches were, and it looks like, Lord, there's maybe no hope in sight, but they know that you're bringing them through to something. Whatever they're going through today, Lord, I pray you would just give them the assurance of your presence with them. Lord, whether it gets worse or better right away, Lord, give them your peace in the midst of it all. Lord, if there are those here who may be compromising in any way with their faith, they're just a little bit confused about some things right now, and they're wanting to be a greater influence on those around for good and not pulling them in the wrong direction, I pray, God, that you would just again kindle that fire in their life. If there's people here who are lukewarm, not hot or cold, Lord, just light that fire in our lives again, that it will catch on to everyone around us. God, we just pray that everyone here who's taken that stand today, you will help them to take the practical things, the steps that they need to do, and make that change, or repent, and be that overcomer that you describe in each of these churches. And Lord, we give you glory for it all. We pray this in Jesus' name. Now, I want you to go today, and I want you to go heavy, like with your tail between your legs, because this was a tough message. Because the Bible says at the end of all these, if you repent and do those things, it talks about them being overcomers. They're going to be the ones who see the victory in the end. And that's you. And if you made that choice today, that's the category in, and you can go with joy, trusting that God is going to do some great things with you.